Oh, oh. You want to get personal.
Where were you born?
Huntsville, Alabama, but technically I don't remember that part.
Name of your first pet?
Mr. Snoofers.
Mr. Snoofers.
That's what I said. Did I pass?
Not yet. First job?
Soldier. Straight out of high school. Left the ranks of full bird colonel.
Then?
Spy.
Where?
It was the Cold War. We were everywhere. Belfast, Bucharest, Belgrade, Budapest. I like the bees. I can make them ride.
Now?
Been riding a desk for the past 6 years, trying to figure out where our future enemies are coming from. Never occurred to me they would be coming from above.
Name a detail so bizarre a Skrull could never fabricate it.
A toast is cut diagonally. I can't eat it. You didn't need that, did you?
No. No, I didn't. But I enjoyed it.
Okay, your turn. Prove you're not a Skrull.
Do you expect me to talk?
Hello, and welcome to episode 143 of Do You Expect Us to Talk? I'm your host, Rebecca, and as always, joined by the marvellous Chris and Dave. How are you both?
Good evening, folks.
You stole my gag, Becca. I was going to say I'm feeling marvellous, but
You say you're feeling marvellous?
Yeah.
Doesn't really work.
No.
And of course, we need to take
I'm feeling gambulous.
As long as you're not feeling lost, unless you'd be all right. I don't think that's even a word.
I'm feeling, what was it? Annette Bening. No, I'm not.
That's one thing.
Does Annette Bening know about this?
What did Mr.
Bening say?
He does now. He's at Buck Palace listening to this with the Queen and Samuel L. Jackson and Riddick Bowe and the Force Ghost of Ronnie Corbett and Queen Latifah and Michael Aspel. Warren Beatty's just joined them. Because his wife's in this and he wanted to see what we thought, and he's just got the most devastating news.
That's the most random listenership.
Yeah.
In all of Christendom.
Of course, they aren't listening to us now. They're all sort of perving over Warren Beatty and his film star looks.
It is, yes.
Mm. Yeah. We're recording this a little bit ahead of time, folks. So
we're really wobbly, timey-wimey.
We could be a little bit out of date with our references tonight, but we'll see.
Warning, a woman has just become PM.
Yeah.
So anyway, tonight we are reviewing
quite the opposite in real time.
She might be on the way out. We'll see what happens.
Yes.
This is all going to be politically irrelevant.
Was she ever a PM to begin with? Yeah. It doesn't fucking seem like it. Anyway.
Well, that's a little bit unfair. I think Maggie Thatcher's doing an okay job, but we are getting news that she could be facing a leadership challenge. But don't worry, the poll tax launches soon, which I'm sure will see her popularity return to normal.
Of course, everyone, we all know how that really turned out. Right.
Super.
Oh dear, oh dear. Yes, this time we are gathering to review, at the time of recording, the latest MCU release, Captain Marvel, starring Brie Larson, Lashana Lynch, Samuel L. Jackson, Annette Bening, Ben Mendelsohn, Clark Gregg, Gemma Chan, Jude Law, and many, many more. With original music by, apologies, I'm going to mispronounce the name, Pinar Toprak, script by Anna Boden and Ryan Fleck, and directed by Anna Boden and Ryan Fleck, and released 2019.
Just to correct Becca there, it's penis topic.
Oh. Well, as soon as I saw it, I was like, oh, where do I know that name from? Fortnite. So,
all right.
I can't pronounce that.
And it also stars Goose the Cat, which apparently is a one over everyone.
Yeah, yes. Goose is right. And it's obviously started off this South Korean meme of having, you know, taking a photoshopping your cat into the poster of Captain Marvel, which I think
they were
a really
so
good
taken
idea.
With it, they took cat off the menu for the next week.
Oh, we should hope so, you know.
Anyway.
That's important.
Okay, they've left cat on the menu.
I
take it back. Sorry to any South Korean listeners.
Yeah, everyone knows they love
to eat
pussy.
Yeah, they're very fussy.
No, I'm sorry. That is not what Chris said.
In for dog meat, no.
Although he would be if this like the airline edit of the show. Well, they're very fuzzy.
Half the film be chopped out.
Yeah, this cat seemed to be a bit of a sort of Jones the Cat. Somebody's an alien fan when they've written this.
Yeah, definitely. It's a bit of a Jones going on.
Yeah.
It's a very cool cat.
If they'd watched it once and thought Jones was the alien.
Yeah.
seen it a few years ago. Yeah.
Yeah, spoiler alert. If you haven't seen Captain Marvel, by the time of this goes out, it won't be available yet. Well, at least in UK territories.
On home release, yeah.
You can obtain it in a legal copy, but we don't condone it. So, Stop now. Go and watch the movie. Come back. Join us, unless you want it all spoiled.
Yeah, we're recording this between our recordings for Civil War and Doctor Strange.
Well, it's fresh in our minds.
That's all it is. Already I'm thinking I'm pushing it because I saw it 4 days ago. I've only seen it once. I'm due to see it again next weekend. Chris, I think you saw it last night, Becca, 2 nights ago?
Yes.
Yeah, so you may be a little bit fresher on it than me. But without getting into all the politics of it, because I really, really don't want to do that, I was a little bit surprised at how this has been received, just on the basis that there was a lot of trolling around it, and I think it shows how limited the pull of the trolls has actually been. Without discussing the trolling itself, I thought this might have a slightly soft opening as a result. It's Marvel, so it's always going to do okay, but it's done very well when you consider it is an origin story. No one should expect this to do as well as like Iron Man 3 or Civil War or something. And actually, in overall gross, it's sort of heading towards that sort of territory.
Yeah. It's still early days, but obviously it's always going to do well, no matter what. It was always going to do at the very least, okay. In regards to, like, what trolls, I mean, whenever there's, like, an internet controversy or whatever, I find it has a little effect on what actually happens in the real world. A lot of people don't actually pay attention. A lot of people aren't actually on Twitter.
No.
So they just go, you know...
That's not the be-all and end-all, is it?
No, I mean, end dates are Marvel films, so people probably turn up just to see, oh, it's a new Marvel film, I'll go and see that. You know, and so it's always had that brand recognition, almost like Pixar to an extent. I find, you know, in terms of how films do well, even in terms of like what even critics say, I don't think that bears any resemblance to what actually happened.
Critics is an odder one for me. I mean, when you say it's Marvel, it'll do well, yeah, but this film is already getting close to matching what the Ant-Man films did overall. So there's definitely sort of a bit of an A-list, B-list thing going on. Amongst it. In terms of critics, I've been thinking about that a lot in recent days, because I think even most critics now say, well, we're not that relevant. All we're there to do is prompt sort of discussion, because films are critic proof. But then I think, well, and the example they always give tends to be Transformers. They always go, well, they did a couple of them did over a billion. And I'm thinking, well, yeah, but that might be a very specific demographic that is critic proof, i.e. young males. They might be critic proof, but then I look at something like Dawn of Justice, which opened massive and then dropped unbelievably, and that might be a mixture of bad word of mouth and critical reaction. The critical reaction was so toxic that those who missed it the first weekend went, oh, forget it. Or maybe asked a friend and said, this isn't being that well received. How did you find it? So I don't know if films are truly critic proof. And I think Transformers, just by nature of the fact that I might be doing it a disservice here, because plenty of people our age liked Transformers in the 80s.
Yeah, sort of grew up with that.
Yeah, so there are 30s and 40 somethings going to see it. But by and large, those films have marketed at very young men. And I'm not convinced. The average, and again, there'll be people listening to this, because our demographic is largely very like us, but there will be, just by the law of averages, some 15, 16-year-old listening to this who thinks, well, that doesn't describe me at all, you know, but does the average 15-year-old eagerly wait to see what Mark Kermode says before they decide to go and see it? I must know what a 56-year-old man thinks.
Yeah.
So I really, really don't know. I don't know that films are entirely critic-proof. The other thought occurs, might a really good Transformers have done Avatar money? you know, it's put, and then you point at Bumblebee, but then you point your Bumblebee doesn't have, as a female lead in a genre that I think will attract the sort of audience that would like a Mark Wahlberg or something, or back in the day a Shia LaBeouf. And of course it's the sixth film and a spin-off, you know what I mean, and not the sexiest lead character of Bumblebee,
and at a competitive time of year as well.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know how well it did, to be honest, Bumblebee, but I imagine it did all right, didn't it?
It did okay, but it's noticeably sort of soft compared to...
Yeah, it wasn't, like, amazing.
I'm just looking now, but I'm not looking on Box Office Mojo because I don't have
Bear in mind, it's just Bumblebee on his own and not, like, the Transformers.
Yeah. At the moment, it's a shade under 460 million, so we're actually looking at it doing sort of solo money,
mm-hmm.
whereas the previous ones sort of did Rogue One money.
Yeah.
In Star Wars terms, so there's been a drop away. I don't know, the critical reaction to this, I think
it's slightly marketed slightly differently as well. I think
it wasn't, I don't know, I'm notably quite impervious to advertising, in that I do surveys online for a site, and have done for a few years, and they often say to me, have you seen this advert or have you seen this billboard, and my answer is virtually always no, because I'm very, very good at ignoring advertising.
Yeah.
Bumblebee, the only advertising I saw for it was trailers in front of about three or four films in the months leading up to it. So I'm not sure it was marketed as heavily as, let's say, the first Transformers film.
No.
And its budget would have been lower, which means its marketing budget would have been lower too.
It could be like a change of tone as well. You know, I mean, I think in terms of... just how well films do. I mean, I think the answer is always like a various of different elements. Sometimes you're onto a winner, sometimes it's a dead cert. I don't know exactly, but I do think it is multiple other things that all contribute to something rather than just one thing. Do you know what I mean? So, in terms of like Bumblebee, it could be just simple as like it's totally different, and people. Just felt like, oh, maybe not, believe it or not, I don't know.
It's E.T., not Independence Day.
Yeah.
In tone, I mean, I saw Bumblebee a little later. I didn't see it in theatrical release, but I did get a rip at one point.
It feels like a smaller film, doesn't it?
I think, because I didn't particularly love Bumblebee as a film, but I didn't hugely dislike it either. I think it got a disproportionately good set of reviews because it wasn't a Michael Bay Transformers film.
Yeah.
It was being reviewed on what it wasn't. And I heard... I'm not saying E.T. by accident. I did read that in the odd review. And yeah. I can totally see that in the tone. But let's not get carried away. It's not remotely the quality of an E.T. But on the plus side, it's not Mac and Me either. So it was a sort of decent middling 3-star film, whereas most sort of Transformers films have been really quite poor. The first half hour of the first one was pretty good, and actually I've only seen a couple of them after that, but I've not enjoyed them, and I don't like that director's sensibility at all.
It did feel like how Transformers kind of should be in terms of its tone, you know. Do you know what I mean? It felt a bit more fun, a bit more light, more hearted, more family friendly.
Yeah, and I felt, and this might be poor memory because it's been a long time since I've seen the originals. The originals, as in the Bay ones, that's all I mean. The originals in this continuity, I suppose, I don't know. But I felt that the Transformers themselves, particularly Bumblebee, was animated with a lot more soul.
Yeah.
And a lot more easily recognisable, whereas... It was much more the sort of outward design, whereas sort of the Bay Transformers films went with kind of almost the guts of the car they were transforming from. And I found that they were less relatable to the humans in the film than this one was. So, I mean, just moving it sort of onto the reaction to this film, certainly it's been good but not outstanding. And now good in Marvel terms means, like, at the time of recording, like 80-ish on Rotten Tomatoes. Now bear in mind, Marvel these days gets like high 80s and up. So it's noted, it's higher than some of the Phase 1 films. It's higher than sort of, you know, Captain America, the first Avenger, a bit higher than, and I mean a bit, not a lot. A couple of points higher than Thor. Higher than like The Incredible Hulk, higher than Iron Man 2. And I'm not sure about the rest. but certainly an awful lot of the films. What made me laugh is a lot of the trolling, and I don't want to go into what the trolling was, but one of the points of the trolls was really funny. They're absolutely convinced Marvel are paying them off, and that Disney own Rotten Tomatoes. Rotten Tomatoes is currently owned by Comcast. They bought it from Time Warner, who still own a significant minority stake, which means it's in the same stable as DC.
Yeah, that's kind of ironic.
So quite the opposite, actually. Building into this film.
You know, our conspiracies get going, you know.
Yeah, but they're bollocks. And I love that. And you get people going, I'd never trust a Rotten Tomatoes reviewer. And I'm thinking, there's no such fucking thing.
No.
And I know one or two people who are accredited. And they just are independent film reviewers who have a body of work such that they've been accredited. They're not paid by anybody. Does that sort of thing go on? Well, it's easy to be cynical. I suppose it's possible, but I'd be very surprised. At this point, Marvel don't have to pay anyone anything. And if Disney was paying people for good reviews, then John Carter, The Lone Ranger, you know what I mean? There's plenty of Disney product that comes out to less than enthusiastic reactions. So I think we'll obviously get into it as we go along, but I think one of the strengths and weaknesses of this film is that Marvel and now so know what they're doing, and I think it's almost to the detriment of this film. I think that it is a production line now. And that's both good and bad. I think it's like going to, it's like comparing like pubs now to like 20 years ago. In that, if you go into a pub now, it's quite often, and I don't go in there very often, but it's quite often like a chain, like a Wetherspoons or something, mm-hmm. and you're guaranteed like a certain standard. Everything looks kind of similar. The food's of a certain standard. The beer's of a certain standard. You know what you're getting. 20 years ago, you could go into like a pub and it might be utter shit, but they had a bit more individual personality. And I think that's probably true of some of the more averagey entries in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, that when it doesn't quite soar, it just feels like the next one off the line.
I definitely get that. Oddly, I didn't have that with this film, though, strangely enough. But I'm curious, what do you think, Becca?
I quite enjoyed the film. It's not perfect. I did try to ignore a lot of what, you know, Troll said, because a lot of it was kind of directed at Brie Larson, and the fact that it is kind of, you know, a majority sort of female led, you know, you've got female in the lead, female directing, female writing, female doing the original music as well, original score, you know, kind of very much being of this generation that we have. A lot of it was unfairly directed at her.
Nick Fury's played by Viola Davis this time.
Yeah, did you know? It's going to be an all female Marvel movie, so. Anybody else who has anything to say?
Ben Mendelsohn underwent gender reassignment.
Benita Mendelsohn. Benny was played by a man.
Yeah, very committed cast.
Even Coulson even was Jones. Played by Jennifer Grey. Even Jones was played by a female kitty.
Yeah. Yeah.
Goose, even.
Yeah.
Dear, dear. No, it's not all female Marvel, don't worry. But no, some of those things, yeah, a lot of the trolling was unfairly directed at her. And yeah, we didn't want to go there because that's not even, it's not even worth commenting on.
Yeah.
So you can just go from me. No.
It's one of my annoyances that, like, you know, the fact that films are now coming politicized, almost extent. Yeah. I mean, I could point fingers, but at the end of the day, the whole point that they're politicized just pisses me off. So I'd rather not. It's better just to kind of talk about the merits of the film.
And to be fair, you're making art at the end of the day. It's just exactly. Like you're going to have people there who's like, oh, if it's not for you, that's fine, jog on, you know, just say, oh, no, this isn't for me, I'm going to go elsewhere, thank you very much.
It's different when the film's not even been released, and then when it does come out, people have gone in with an opinion. It's everything in this life now.
It's what happens when that does happen, though, and that's always like, oh, fuck's sake, can we, you know.
Yeah, but it's everything in life. Everything is filtered by people's own prejudices and ideas. I mean, you've only got to read without naming names when somebody famous...
And it's easy to shitster as well. Look at
when somebody famous is accused of something. It splits into two camps of they're guilty or they're innocent. And it is based entirely on whether the person commenting likes that person. That's all it is.
Case in point recently, like with Johnny Depp.
Yeah.
That came out that Amber Heard was abusing him, supposedly. So, were they both abusive,
I suspect it was a toxic relationship with a shitload of alcohol flowing, frankly.
Probably.
But I'm not here to defend Johnny Depp. I saw a certain video of Johnny Depp that was extremely concerning, to say the least.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you are allowed not to know. You are allowed to go, it's their business and we don't fucking know. And I find that I find that true of an awful lot of things. You know, the number of people telling me, you know, saying on social media Michael Jackson's innocent, well, he might fucking be. But your main reason for saying he's innocent is you like Michael Jackson's music. That's all it is. And I think the same is true on a far, far less serious note with a film like this. People decide they don't like it because they can't stand feminism and or female leads or whatever else it might be. Or they've overreacted to a perceived politicisation as well. If you come out of the film and go, Jesus Christ, what a load of liberal bullshit, if you're of a conservative bent, then that's something quite different. But people are getting... Yeah, people's opinions are definitive, absolute and unchangeable. And that's really concerning. And I think there's a lack of perspective as well. This is a film. You know, it's a bit like, we don't get a lot of it, but it's a bit like when people get like, I've had it with a couple of our shows where people have got angry with us over something, but it'll typically be where we fucking ranked The Spy Who Loved Me or something. And it's like, this is light entertainment. You know, there was somebody a long time ago got quite upset with our review of, our review of The Dark Knight Rises.
Oh yeah.
This is light entertainment. That's all it is. Listen to it, disagree and move on.
Yeah,
same is true of Captain Marvel. There's bigger stakes because hundreds of millions put into it, and theoretically, of course, although they could stand to have a couple of flops, theoretically people's jobs are linked to it, so it matters, but it don't matter that much, not to you and not to your life. Because if you don't like this, like, you know, Shazam's out next month, and if you don't like that, Hellboy's out in the middle of the month, and if you don't like either of them, if you know, Avengers Endgame's out. Do you know what I mean? It doesn't matter. Just fucking calm down.
Yeah. Oh, God.
Mm.
But my God, Eon Cell. Give us more Bond films.
Eon, for fuck's sake, get on with it. Yeah, put your finger out.
Yeah, but I cop to that, actually. There's a slight hypocrisy in what I've just said.
No, I am joking
about
that.
That's because
fashion of making more rather than like...
But the difference there is, we'll have a rant about it, and 10 minutes after we finish recording, if we're still up and talking, depending on when we record, we're talking about something else.
Yeah,
It's not that important.
I can kind of see it from both sides. I mean, you know, we are fans. I mean, take Bond, for example. If they decide to, if, you know, Barbara and Michael put out a thing tomorrow saying, okay, Idris Elba is the next Bond, or Brie Larson is the next Bond, or Olivia Colman is the next Bond, you know, or Goose the Cat is the next Bond, it'll be like, oh my God, you know, rah, 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 this rails against everything, you know, but it's kind of like, okay, you know, that's it, we just got to take it on the chin. I'm like, yes, this is really, you know, this is what we want, this is next evolution in the character, and it's just, you know, we are fans and we are passionate about what we love. At the same time, it is just a film.
The only thing is, with something like Bond, there's a worldwide fan base, and they are in the business of making Bond films.
Exactly. So yeah, that's what they do.
I think they owe us Bond films. What they don't owe us is our vision of a Bond film. They don't owe me the person I want as Bond in the plot I want, with the woman I want, the car I want, the antagonist I want.
Mm.
You know, I've seen some really wrong-headed kind of... you know, change.org fucking literally people petitioning to let the fans have more of a say. Well, isn't everything we've talked about tonight proof that they shouldn't, us included? We're not
well, yeah. for me, remember with the Clive Owen thing when Craig was announced.
Yeah, that would have been, in my view, a bad idea. Clive Owen looks right in a still photo, but he's got one of the dullest voices in history. And again, you're casting him because he was in Croupier. If he'd never made that film and never made The Chancer, I think it was. I get confused with that and The Charmer, which was Nigel, whatever he was called. I just think, you know, fans only filter through things through what they already know. So they pick an actor they like. You know, Bryan Cranston, let's have him play Lex Luthor. Why? Because he was bald for a while in that TV show. There is nothing in any recent take of Lex Luthor I've seen that would suit him. And we're not putting ourselves, I don't think, I'm certainly not putting myself above the fan base and saying I know better than at all. I'm just not. I include myself in that because when, you know, my current ideas of Bond and who Bond should be are based on distance or not from Daniel Craig. And back when Brosnan was Bond, I had ideas on who should be Bond, and they were variants of Pierce Brosnan in a strange kind of way. So, you know, in some respects, creatives need to do it. Creatives need to see what they're skilled to see. They haven't actually got... I may not be the biggest Roger Moore or Pierce Brosnan fan, but they haven't really got any of their choices outright wrong. It's just the fact that 5 years each time is too much. And if you're in the business of making those films, you've got a fan base waiting for them. I think it's your duty to be making them at a closer together than this, but it's not your duty to satisfy what I want to see in them. And it's the same with the Marvel Universe. You know, there are people out there who, let's be honest, don't really want a female-led film unless it's Black Widow, because they're used to Black Widow. They've seen her for years, so they could that's less of a leap for them. Marvel don't owe you anything.
I mean, Captain Marvel isn't a particularly well-renowned comic, though. I mean, granted, I can't really tell you what other female superheroes there are. I suspect it's not necessarily like that, but I think a lot of it is due to like social media does, because what social media is basically people shouting their opinions on a screen. Essentially, it's
the
same
behind the keyboard and do it, can't they?
Yeah, it's the same kind of principle. You know, when you're like in the car and then someone cuts you off, and you shout
what you want, maybe it's gonna
shout the wanker. But if someone like cuts you off like on the street, like in person, you don't shout the wanker, do you? You know, they
well.
Well, some people, but the amount of the population who do significantly reduces. People joke that, oh shit, sorry mate, and they're actually quite pleasant. I mean, you know,
I know it's a place to share, I know it's a place to share opinions, and we have a podcast that's designed to share opinions, and I write articles to share opinions. But they're just little think pieces, and this podcast is a chat between three people who know and trust each other. Mm-hmm. In some respects, on social media, I just think it's all right to keep your mouth shut sometimes. Funnily enough, I don't go on these threads and start spitting out my opinions left, right and centre. I might do a little post on mine sometimes, but what I don't do is get onto a Marvel thread or something and start telling people they're talking shit. I just don't do that. I don't see any benefit to it.
Yeah, that's not cool.
And it's a lifetime of arguing with people over different things and never really changing anyone's mind. You know, Chris, have you ever talked politics with anyone and they've walked away going, that's changed my whole outlook? It doesn't happen very often.
Not on Twitter, because people are like, it's impossible to really have a proper discussion.
No,
because,
but in life it doesn't happen, even when I've had time to really think about what I want to say.
Yeah.
You know, I'm very, very careful not to talk about some of the hot button issues with people I work with at the moment, because I know they feel the exact opposite way to me. And all we do is argue and come away with the exact same point of view. So what's the point? And it's the same with this sort of thing. I'm not saying don't discuss it, but it's just, I find it so reductive. No, what we're going to say tonight is whether we like it, but we'll try and talk for an hour or two about why.
Yeah. I'm like, what? You mean about the actual film and not the shit surrounding the film?
Not Chris gives an opinion.
That's controversial.
Not Chris gives an opinion. I'll say you couldn't be more wrong. Good night, folks. You know, it's just, I find that's the problem with social media. It is people just shouting the headline opinion. That's it.
Yeah.
And it's actually
people sharing articles, only reading the headline, saying, "Look at this," yeah. And it's like, and you know, if you actually read it, it's like you find out there's probably nothing in it.
No one reads the article. That's another thing.
Yeah.
No, you know, you'll see someone pick up a factual point.
Or step outside their own worldview. Like, yeah. It's okay, well, you know, I have my opinion, but let's try and see what others might even think. You know, yeah. What others might actually see. What's their worldview be different from mine? You know, they see things differently, and it's the lack of tolerance towards that. It's just insane right now.
Well, I mean, you go back to Wonder Woman, and it will have happened with this to some degree as well. But I've yet to see the shots of it, the photos, if you like. But there were lots of photos of little girls, and I mean very little girls, like five to 6 year olds, something like that, in Wonder Woman outfits, just so excited to be seeing it. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking, well, that makes the whole enterprise worth it, whatever some fucking 30-year-old thinks of it.
Yeah.
And I think the same is true with this. All Marvel is aimed at everyone, and it's all aimed at us to a certain degree, because we've always enjoyed these types of films. But there is a wrinkle in this, in that it is a lot more feminized, and that there's absolutely nothing wrong with that, because everyone kind of deserves a right to feel a little bit represented. That's why the backlash against like Black Panther pissed me off a little bit. Forget the film quality for a minute, we'll talk about that a few weeks ago, but the very fact that there was such pent-up demand for that film tells you something. That there was a universe not servicing a certain portion of audience, and quite a sizable one at that, as the box office said. As for this, though, Becca, so you enjoyed it, Chris?
Frustrating, shall we say, is my initial verdict on the film.
Perfect, it's flawed for sure.
So Becca, what things did you like about it? Like, before I go into my opinion, you enjoy your time with it.
I did, but then I didn't see it in 3D, so I was like, oh, look how bright it is, oh, sorry, I was dazzled by the bright colours. Yes, it's not perfect, it's flawed for sure, takes an absolute age to get going, and as you kind of said in the preamble, I spent a lot of time confused about who she is, and what her role in it is. I must admit, going in, I said this from the outset, sadly I've not read many of the comics apart from like one or two of the Thor comics, which belong to my lovely late granddad. But so yeah, I'm probably at least familiar with this sort of character, and also with the character of Doctor Strange, as we'll come to next time, previously.
as we'll come to 6 weeks
in the future. Yeah. In the past.
Hang on, Becca, I'm just getting news coming through. The Beatles have split up.
Oh dear!
McCartney's looking at a potential new project with his new wife, but not been confirmed.
No.
Sorry to interrupt, but that was.
I blame Yoko.
That was too. That was too big to leave. Sorry, folks. Carry on.
I'm over really stoked by myself.
Oh dear. I'll just stick with the Hoover. Never mind. No, it's all a bit wibbly wobbly timey wimey. As I say, it's not perfect, definitely, but no, I you know, had a good time with it. I think Brie Larson, she is Captain Marvel. I do admire her as an actress, definitely. It's quite interesting having Ben Mendelsohn, who isn't, you know, we were saying earlier, is known now for sort of playing slimy, kind of slightly villainous characters as well, and his character is kind of, it's quite challenging. It just toys with who's the villain, who's the terrorist, who's the freedom fighter. But our perception of him and his character are pushed throughout this film. Likewise with Jude Law's character as well. You might think, oh, he's trying to help, Captain Marvel trying to help. Oh, what's her name? Annette Bening's character. And
she's going under Dr. Lawson, isn't she, for most of the film?
Yeah, that's it. I couldn't remember her name.
Wendy Lawson.
Carol Danvers. That's her real name. That's it. It's kind of, it plays with notions of identity as well. And also, with regard to the Jude Law character as well, I was chatting to you guys, I was chatting to somebody, I think it was one of my friends, actually. You can see how it's almost like she's in an abusive relationship as well, and he's trying to sort of control and manipulate her, and saying, oh no, it's, you should be this way, you shouldn't be that way. It's all about her trying to break out of that relationship, and say, no, I'm my own person, I'm an individual, I know what my destiny is, I know what I've set out to achieve, and I know what I can achieve. So you can. There's also that side of the narrative as well. But no, as I say, it's flawed, it's not perfect, but generally I had a good time with it, I enjoyed it. Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing it again when it does come out on home release eventually. Effects are really good, visuals are great, moved it along at a really cracking pace, brilliant score as well. I think I do tend to struggle, this is going to sound really stupid, I apologise, but I'm one of these people who's kind of like, I do get on with like the auto theory quite a bit, and I do struggle if you've got the dual, you know, two people writing and directing, I'm a little bit like, oh, but it's perfectly fine here, not a problem at all.
So Becca wants to cancel Endgame because two of you, piss off!
No, I'm a bit like special. Like, I'm always sort of like, oh, I can't cope. Oh my god, I find it a bit overwhelming. But it's fine. This, you know, as Bond has always been written by two people, and well, not always, but for the majority, it's fine. I don't really have a problem with it.
Well, it stops like, when Bond have two of them, it stops you doing something really silly like knighting someone after 14 months. So yeah.
But then again, you know, I tend to watch a lot of like anime and cartoons, and obviously that's all made by committee. So
yeah,
hypocritical there, but never mind.
Well, it depends on the vision, though, isn't it? It's the ultimate, you know, who's steering the boat, so to speak. But yeah, I wouldn't know too much about the animation side of it. For me, it was just really frustrating. As I think at the beginning of the podcast. I went into it, first off, the Stan Lee on the Marvel thing, really good job, really nice touch. And it started, I was actually really ready to really like this film. After going in, not being too sure, but it's like, actually, you know what, I'm going to really, you know, going to give it a fair chance. And it started the first like 10, 15 minutes or so, I was like, you know what, I'm really liking this. This seems pretty good. I'm really, really on board with it. And then I think it was like you get to like the memory thing that when we go through our old memories, I thought, oh, this is kind of interesting, hearing like, you know, Ben Melson talk over the voiceover, like, so that's unusual, but I kind of like that. And then when she finally escaped, I felt Brie Larson wasn't right with the way she was handling the reaction. It wasn't like something was a vibing, but I was like, you know what, whatever. You know, maybe she hadn't sort of like found a thing in the action, but in terms of the other scenes, like where she's actually talking to people, fine. And then she's up, and then she goes on Earth, and all of a sudden I thought, oh no, it's a fish out of water where we haven't actually established how out of water she is. And at the same, do you know what I mean? There's no contextual evidence from where she came from to apply to modern day Earth.
Because that place on Hala. Or whatever it's called could well be, that could just be effectively an analogue for a modern Earth city. We don't see enough of it to know.
Yeah.
No.
And also you have the added confusion of the, well, of her confusion of like, oh, but I'm remembering who I am. So it's like, so at one point it's kind of like four, and at one point it's kind of like the Bourne identity. And I found it was just kind of like a meta. It didn't really gel or work. It then starts as like, you know, establish the Skrulls there. It has a really fun concept of them being shapeshifters that I really liked, and then it kind of became like a Samuel Jackson buddy film, which I kind of liked, but at the same time it kind of just shifted from one to the other, and I just felt it was just a bit of a mess. And by the time I walked out of the film, I kind of felt, thinking, all right, why is it that it worked? And then suddenly hit me, I couldn't tell you a single thing about her as a person. I can tell about, like, you know, how she got her powers and what she did and what she can do, so to speak, but in terms of her as a person, I cannot, for the life of me, give you a discernible thing to say, and I think ultimately that is the key flaw in this film. I still don't know who Captain Marvel is.
I think that might be fair. I think I'm just balancing whether I think it's deliberate or not, because there is a godlike quality to her at the end, like you get in some takes of Superman, and a certain distancing from everyone else when she becomes an Avenger may not be that odd or out of place. We'll just have to see. I did a written review of this film, and I gave it a rating and immediately thought, I've been too generous. The reason I thought I'd been too generous, I gave it a 4-star review. Although the detail of the review I largely agree with still, because I was pointing out issues with it. But it felt like a weak 4 anyway. It was like it had to be a 3 or a 4. It's awkward because you do things. I did 2 4-star reviews that weekend, and I wanted one to be a 5 and one to be a 3, really. And when you balance them both out as 4s, it's almost like you're saying to everyone they're roughly equivalent in quality. And they're not. One was on the verge of a 4-star. It had a ton of flaws, but I loved it. This one had fewer flaws, but just didn't stand out to me in some ways. But I also...
There's always 2 versions of a star rating, isn't there? There's the 3-star rating, which is like, yeah, it's pretty good, you should go see it. And then there's a 3-star, which is like, yeah, it's good, but...
Yeah. Aquaman was the latter, for example. I gave Aquaman a 3-star review, and I don't think that's generous, but, like, the film is a mess. The film is a mess. It got through on being quite a lot of fun. I think with this, it was a very soft 4-star anyway. I can still defend it, I can still stand by it, but you could make an argument for the one below it. Just because I think, I had a feeling, and I've got a second viewing coming this weekend, but I had a feeling that pacing was covering a lot of flaws. And we'll see if that's true over time. The pacing of this film is actually magnificent. It's one of the best paced films in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Very few lulls in it. The lulls all work for me. And the key point was, she finds out her backstory about, I thought, 3/4 of an hour in, and I just reached into my pocket just to illuminate my phone, just to find out how long it had been, and it had been 70 minutes. So the pacing of this film's absolutely superb. On other positive notes, I thought Brie Larson is giving a performance that's very much within the material. It's not a Robert Downey Jr. or a Chris Hemsworth. They aren't coming and sort of knocking you out with their charisma and everything else. She's not doing that here. But within the role, I felt she was very comfortable, and it's a deceptively difficult role because she's an amnesiac at points. She's a very green sort of apprentice at some point. At some point, she's a very sassy apprentice, you know, giving it lip to her master, if you like. At some point, she's scared, and towards the end...
She's the one who knows the most amongst characters, but at the same time, doesn't know anything.
Yeah, and towards the end, she has to adopt quite a swagger. And I think she did that. I think she absolutely owned the screen. I don't know how this will translate at home, but I thought she had absolutely impressive big screen presence. And she's spending a lot of scenes with Samuel L. Jackson, who's very noted for that. So I'm very positive about her, with the caveat that I don't know too much about the Captain Marvel character. So you get a lot of it should have been Katie Sackhoff or something. Well, Katie Sackhoff might be pushing on a bit in years now to start a role like this. But even if that's not the case, she's a bit too C-list for this, to be honest. But, you know, whatever. I thought the de-aging work was good, with one massive caveat I'll point out as we go through. But that was all very good. I think the very first shot of Nick Fury doesn't work properly. It looks almost like a digital face replacement, but thereafter it settles down or I get used to it.
Yeah, it does look a little bit at first. I think even with Clark Gregg, he doesn't look that old anyway. But he didn't have to have much digital wrinkle removal and digital Botox. I just remember, like, first, you know, that X-Men movie, you know, when it first occurred, when I first saw it, and was like, oh, this looks a bit weird. But obviously now, 10 years on...
It's the hair.
Mark, yeah, exactly. You know, yeah, it's very odd, isn't it?
They don't seem to be able to do male toupees. When you think
I think they did so well with Sean Connery.
Well, when they didn't, did they? His wig's rubbish, by and large. but the point is, you look at so many female characters we've seen in film and TV over the years, and had I not known different, I wouldn't have known it was a hairpiece.
Yeah, lovely.
Scarlett, a lot of the time, in most of her films, because she keeps her hair fairly short. Gillian Anderson, I've never really watched The X-Files, but I've seen tons of... It didn't appeal to me, Becca. Fucking let it go.
Funny joke.
But it's fine. I've never spotted that. More so in the sort of newer ones. Back in the 90s, it kind of looked like a hairpiece when it might not have been. And now it doesn't. But on men, honestly, on both of them, it looks like the toupees have been made by someone who once had the concept of hair described to them. They've never actually seen it, so does it look a bit like this? Nick Fury's looks painted on, and Phil Coulson just looks like he should be in a Wham video, right?
It's very 80s, isn't it?
They've almost gone 10 years, but that might be deliberate. You might hear on the sort of commentary, you know, he's a bit of an old-fashioned guy, so we've actually gone 10 years before.
I don't know.
When I say Wham, I don't mean he's got a party in the back. I just mean it's a bit, it's a little bit quiffy and highlighty. But bear in mind, I've seen it once. I might watch it again and go, what the fuck was I describing?
And then you watch Jim and S.H.I.E.L.D. and it's like, what?
Was it a bit like Mel Gibson in Lethal Weapon?
No.
Like Comey?
No, I don't think so. But
The thing I will say about Coulson is, it kind of feels obvious that he needs to be in this, because if Fury's going to be here, you're going to have Coulson.
Yeah. Well, it's the very beginning of S.H.I.E.L.D. as well, isn't it, for him? So.
Yeah.
There was no point to him.
Yeah, so, well, exactly. I was about to say, like, but what is the point to him being in the film?
But some other positives. So I'm positive about her. I'm positive about Jackson. I'm very positive about the pacing. I'm very positive about her performance in terms of being the swaggering superhero by the end. I also think I've got to be positive about Ben Mendelsohn, because I've given him a hard time. But I've given him a hard time from, like, it's almost been tough love, because I genuinely, wholeheartedly think Ben Mendelsohn is one of the most talented actors I've ever seen in my life. I mean that. A lot of that comes from something I've mentioned before a couple of times and will never mention again after tonight. A Netflix original series called Bloodline, where he played the sort of black sheep of the family with addiction problems and a bit of a waster. And then when he turned up in something like The Dark Knight Rises, which I think I saw before, actually, so I probably wouldn't have realised it was him. It was probably more when he played Krennic or something. And he was much more sort of upright and officious. I thought, well, there's a different take on sort of evil, and not even evil to a large degree. So I thought that shows some range. But since then, I've seen him do the same role over and over and over and over again.
He's become a bit kind of pigeonholed really now, hasn't he, unfortunately?
He's not having an unsuccessful career. He's not having a career anyone should be ashamed of, but he's capable of more. This should be like an award-winning actor. He's that talented. And that doesn't mean he can't go and do Marvel, but it just means don't keep going and doing the same role.
They keep doing, moustache-twirling villain.
I don't think I even realised he was Australian. So to actually see him playing effectively a dual role, it's not the hardest role in the world, but he plays it, and he plays it very well. And sort
under
of
a ton of makeup,
art.
Too.
Under a ton of makeup, which is a bit more of a negative, because I've seen the comic book incarnation of the Skrulls, and this does look like, you know, man in mask. But I think the film has a fair bit of heart. I think it's got a fair run to it. I think the humour works all right. The dialogue, without having any specific examples, because I've only seen it once, the dialogue was a bit weak in places. They were spitting, you know, comic book lines at each other. Really impressed Becca picked out on something I forgot to even mention in the review I wrote, the whole abusive relationship thing. It's a PG-13 film, so they can't overstate it, but
it's just one way of reading the film. That's just something that a friend texted me.
When you think about abusive women, they often feel, and I'm no expert on this, so I'm notably not going to talk about it for very long because it's an awkward subject, but when you, some abusive women don't leave the person abusing them because they feel they can't manage without them. They feel like that person gives them the strength to get by, when actually quite the opposite is happening. And this film is an analogue for that. It doesn't overly bang the drum on it, but she thinks she's got powers in that thing in her neck. What she's actually got is a restraining bolt. And I found that quite interesting. For the film as a whole, I thought it was a little bit Phase 1. This was a little bit like Thor. I prefer it to Thor, but partly because there's a bit more money on it. I mean, you know, she arrives in a living, breathing world, whereas Thor arrived in a very cheap backlot. Is this character the Thor, the star Thor is in this universe? I don't know. Time will tell. It's a touch forgettable, if anything. It's middling Marvel. It feels very formula, and again, I'd need to see it several times to actually hit on why, but it was hitting beats here and there where I go, well, that's what a Marvel film does, and about now that's what a Marvel film does. But to its credit, my third act problem doesn't kick in the traditional way. I think it laces action through it really nicely, so when it builds to this, you know, 20 minutes of bullshit at the end, it does feel like the natural culmination of her journey. The only worry I've got is this character is now ludicrously overpowered. And it is a bit like having Superman in your universe. What do you do? They're better kept off in their own films, because they are a get-out-of-jail-free card unless you write them very, very carefully. And I think that's all I really wanted to say for now.
Yeah, it can kind of be... It kind of, like, ruin, like, the aesthetic of the original lineup now, because, let's just say, all this time, all this build-up with Thanos, and they're like, oh, shit, we need help, and then... And I'm assuming they're not going to do this.
No, I don't think they will. They're smarter than that, I think.
But potentially, and that's what it seems like. She's that like powdered. Like it'd be, she could turn up and go, oh, I've got it, and I'll defeat Thanos 4 years here. I say that though, because yeah. I did think this afterwards. I did think yes, but we did see Thanos just beat the shit out of Hulk. So
I think also as well,
and I'm not sure how he did it, but
I think well, he already had the Power Stone. But when you think about it, I thought that a Vision when we first saw him. I thought, what is this guy's skill set? He can phase through everything, blow things out of the sky very easily, is impossibly strong, impossibly fast, and actually they used him sparingly and in a way where it's not such a problem. You could have the same problem with Scarlet Witch. You could have the same problem with Doctor Strange. Does anything mean anything when he can just change time? So it is about execution. The DC, the lazy DC Justice League version was to wait till Act 3 and then unleash Superman. You know what I mean? Well, I'm hoping they don't do this here and they do something a little bit better. But that's my only worry with the character. But at the end, I really felt like an A-lister has arrived. And I don't mean Brie Larson, I mean Captain Marvel. An A-lister has arrived. So I was impressed by that. But it's in the middle somewhere. It's kind of somewhere near a first Avenger. This will be controversial because a lot of people love it. But like a Thor Ragnarok. Thor Ragnarok's a load of fun. But it doesn't have the most cohesive, interesting plot. It's a series of skits. Let's see if I feel that way when I review it 5 weeks ago. You know, we'll just have to see whether I feel that. But that was my overwhelming feeling. That, you know, that was that film and Iron Man and the Captain America films are all better on, like, individual personality. This film is probably a little bit better on cohesive plot and pacing. But it's not special. And for an A-list character, I was what will be clearly designed to be an A-list character in this universe, I was hoping for something of like Black Panther standard. Not necessarily Civil War standard or Winter Soldier standard, but maybe Black Panther standard. And by the time you're hearing this, listeners, you'll know what I mean by that because we'll have reviewed it. It isn't quite that.
Yeah, I mean... I go back to say I think my it was just ultimate frustration because I saw a lot of potential, saw a lot of like a fun idea of the Skrulls. I like the twist of them being good guys.
Yeah.
Even though I can kind of tell from the trailers that like Jude Law or that lot would probably turn out to be a bad guy. At least Jude Law.
Yeah, well, it wasn't really a twist. I don't think. Sorry to interrupt. Yeah. But yeah.
No, I mean, they kind of, like, almost, like, give the game away with, like, say, oh, the Kree. Oh, okay. Well,
well, of course he was an evil guy. He's got, like, a widow's peak.
He's got a British accent.
And a British accent.
He's English.
Yeah. That's why the antagonist in 1978's Superman was Ray Reardon.
Of course.
Attack Superman with his snooker cue.
But, yeah, I saw, like, a lot of potential idea, and I even saw, like, just little moments in Brie Larson, just like I just didn't come together, you know, like, whether that be giving a little bit of sass or whether that you know,
I think the sequel would be better.
Yeah, I mean, I'm best. I mean, probably even in Endgame, Russo's might sort of edge something like there, that like tweak something that gives.
On
that
the
gives
evidence
it.
Of this, the Russos are better filmmakers.
Yeah.
But with that, shall we discuss this film sequentially?
Oh, go on then. So, do you want to talk about the Stan Lee thing?
Yeah. In context, out of context, I don't know what happened in your screenings, but out of context, this sounds kind of cheesy.
20 people.
I think I saw it with about 5 others. I wanted to avoid all the chavs and everything on the Friday and Saturday.
I was in the biggest screen, and it was full. And the Stan Lee cameo, the Marvel logo came up, and for a split second, you don't know what you're seeing. Because the colour palette looked off, so I just thought, oh, they've changed it again. And then I suddenly realised, oh, it's Stan Lee. They're going to seed him in. And then, oh, that's Stan Lee. Oh, right, this is all Stan Lee.
That's all my different Stan Lee.
And there was an audible, not a gasp, but kind of just a, oh, I've got what they're doing. Everyone clued in at the same time. And then it stopped and faded out or cut out, and it said, thank you, Stan. And there was a slight from a couple of people.
Yeah.
And then everyone thought, right.
Hello, cat.
But then everyone joined in. Everyone joined in, everyone applauded, and me being very British and a bit embarrassed joined in just as it was about to stop. I was like, alright. So I kind of went, right. That was it.
Did you be like the guy who, like, sort of as it ends, just does a.
Yeah. I was there at the end, that's all that matters. No, I did applaud because I thought.
You have the final word.
But again, you take all those things, you think British audiences don't do that. Talking back to a screen is odd as a concept anyway. And it all sounds very cheesy. In context, it was surprisingly quite moving. And I'm kind of glad it happened. It was a nice little moment. And obviously, by contrast, I think his cameo was a little bit overdone, but we'll come to that. I like the concept of it. There was something in his cameo, but of course they had to use reshoots to add a couple of extra little beats, and it kind of ruined it. But we'll come to that.
It probably would have been fine. Let's just say Stan Lee didn't die.
Yeah.
And so they did have the regular logo, and that was, and the actual camera we did have probably would have played a lot better.
Yeah, I think they've tweaked it to make it a bit more of a moment.
Mm.
It reminded me of, is it Spider-Man 2 or 3?
Yeah.
One of the Spider-Man films, I think it's 3, the Tobey Maguire ones, where he stands next to Tobey Maguire and he turns and he says something like, seems one man can make a difference. Nuff said. But there's a bit of a gap before he says nuff said, and with the camera's on it a few beats too long, and I just go, fuck me, that's cheesy. It was a little bit like that. We'll get to it in a minute, but his cameo goes on several beats too long, but we'll come to it. This film starts on the capital of the Kree Empire, Hala. Now, the one thing I do want to say is, did anyone come out of that film knowing the name of Jude Law's character, or have we all had to look it up?
I just thought it was just Jude Law.
I had to look that one
up. It's nice to play myself, finally.
Oh.
Yeah,
I am Captain Marvel's mentor / potential bad guy. That's what I thought going
slash
in.
English villain.
Yeah, I was kind of caught. I mean, I dropped a big hint in the review because I said Yoda / Henry Ducard, which is a huge hint as to what he is. But yeah, I didn't know his name. Had to look it up, and still do. It hasn't taken. I still need to look each time. It's Yon Rock. Mm. She's having dreams involving an older woman.
Ooh.
I love the way that's written on Wikipedia.
Not quite like that.
Yeah, I've had those.
Somewhere, and that means going, how dare you?
Yeah. I really, the whole dreams motif is played really well, and we'll get to it, because it reminds me of another film, but we'll come to it. And she's still sort of being trained, isn't she? She's having training sessions with Jude Law. Mm. We'll just call him Jude Law from now on. And it's about control of ability. So again, the film is setting up in this sort of abused woman motif almost, and I don't want to overstate that, but there's the merest hint of it. But it's setting up that, like, he's trying to teach her to control it. Well, actually, he's already controlled it. She's already very sort of buttoned down, isn't she, in terms of what she can use. But were these blasts coming from her body? She had... that is coming from her body, isn't it? The blast from her hands.
Yeah.
Right, okay. But it's all about keeping your emotions in check, which is very Yoda.
What was the advice? Was he sort of like, think with your head, not with your heart?
Yes. Or was stop it using this, around? Start using this, pointed at her head when they were on the tube or something.
To me, that doesn't make much sense, because surely that would be implied... you know, that would be implied sort of like her memories then, if she has to start thinking with her head. To me, I just thought, hang on, wouldn't that sort of mean the more likelihood for her to kind of
start
remembering stuff?
I sort of think this is what I was getting at. That's a stock mentor pupil line.
Yeah.
And a lot of the dialogue between those two is like that. Like I say, we're a bit hamstrung by seeing it once. If I knew this film really well, if I knew this film as well as I knew, say, Batman Begins, I'd be able to go, when they said that was a poor line or whatever. But several times I thought the dialogue was kind of clunky. Marvel have this, if they've got one flaw and it's not a major flaw, the characters talk at each other, not with each other. Brie and Samuel L. are a bit like that as well, as characters. They sort of talk at each other, not with each other. But it's okay. They've then got to go on some mission, haven't they? Oh, we have the concept of the supreme intelligence given to us at this point.
Yeah.
It's an artificial intelligence they all commune with, and they see what they want to see, really. They see a manifestation of the person they respect the most. So she sees Dr. Wendy Lawson without knowing who she is. It's the woman in her dreams.
Not the woman of her dreams.
Not the woman of her dreams. I can see.
Yeah, the
idea. I can see why Brie Larson doesn't want to be interviewed by like middle-aged men now. Me going in. And
would
saying,
you know?
Tell us, Brie, who's the woman of your dreams?
Well, she goes in there and sees herself and says, "Ah, it's a bit like Harry Potter looking in the mirror of Erised Desire. It's like seeing what you most want to be, you know, what you desire. In fact, so
never made that link. Yeah, it is. It's totally like that.
You can see what you want to see, or see who, you know, the person that you look up to or that you most admire, as they say. But what else, going back to the start of the film as well, you mentioned about having like powers or lack of, like all the way through the film, as well as saying, you know, think with your head, not with your heart, for example. He's always, both like him and Annette Bening are like, you know, these powers that we've given you can be taken away, or words to that effect as well. That's another point that seems to be hammered home throughout the film.
Treating it like she's in a privileged position.
Yeah, like she's been, you know, she wasn't born with them. She's kind of granted, you know, these are for you. Treat them well, use them wisely. But if you screw up,
she's referred to as Vers, isn't she? Which is obviously short for Danvers.
Yeah, Vers. Danvers. But they call her Vers, but not.
Yeah, the pronunciation's all over the place, because I've heard other podcasts that's Vers. I heard it as Vers, but whichever you want to call it, and you're probably right, Becca, it probably is Vers. But
well, I don't
it
know.
Was
I'm
clearly
a bit special myself. But, so yeah, when it comes out on Blu-ray, I'm going to be there with the subtitles. Right, what do they say?
The film, well, they'll just spell it. It'll be Vers. But that was meant to be a big reveal at the end. It was fucking obvious. Well, obviously they've only got like half of her name from somewhere.
Yeah.
Anyway,
full
right.
Full of Caro.
So yeah, they go on to a mission to pull a spy out that's been in with a group of Skrulls. The Skrulls are shapeshifters the Kree are at war with. This in tone felt a little bit Rogue One in places. You know the bit of Rogue One where they've got to go and sort of get the,
especially like with the rifle, like sniper rifle bit as well.
Yeah, it's fine. Again, at this point, it's how these films start. You know, start with a set piece, little bit of introduction, then a set piece. It's fine. She's captured by Talos, Ben Mendelsohn's character. Because they're shapeshifters, so they're never quite sure who they're stood next to and stuff like that. The memory probe. Now, I just want to say a little bit about memory. I forget which part of the film it happens in, where she. obviously, because my memory doesn't work. They have.
Sorry, I'm not laughing at you, Dave. I'm sorry.
Yes.
Just laughing at the concept.
Yeah, I want to talk about memory because I forgot.
Sorry. I'm not being rude. I didn't mean to be rude.
No, it's all right.
I suffer from memory problems as well, so I do.
I don't at all. I suffer with talking shit problems. The whole memory thing very much reminded me of Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, because there is a bit where she's talking to Annette Bening, and then she turns around and talks to her again, and then she can only see the back of her head and things like that. Well, there's a bit in Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind where he goes into a store where Clementine is working, and there's a guy there talking to her, but when he walks around this guy, he's only got the back of her head, and that's because that's all he saw in reality. There's no face to put on him because he never saw it. So this idea of memory being like interpretive, limited to what you've seen, and sometimes if you're seeing it in kind of a dream, sometimes in light phases of dreams, your dreams can be affected by external noises. So sometimes an alarm will go off and then you hear an alarm in your dream, and there's a bit of that going on as well. The voice is getting to her and things like that. I really like the dream.
Focus on the badge.
Any other film would have gone with a straight flashback, adding a bit more detail each time, and this film didn't, and I like that.
Yeah. So I was fully on board with this. I was like, oh, this is something different. This is new.
Yeah.
I kind of like this.
Yeah.
But yeah, we basically establish certain background things, like sort of fast forwards or rewinds, and it takes us to meeting with the older woman. and they're trying to find out who she is, because obviously they recognize her. They're trying to locate where they are, so they have a look at a badge. And I'm assuming they make, though I could have missed this, I'm assuming they take the decision to go to Earth then?
I'm assuming so, because her escape seems to drop her right on Earth, and the film doesn't really sell that to us. It's like, well, that was convenient. Well, of course, they were heading that way. So it's just a little beat that something's been a little lost in the edit, but it's not major. She gets into an escape pod, after some action shenanigans, but basically the gist is
shenanigans.
Well, it's all very rote at this stage.
General shenanigans.
She moves okay, but we don't really know the character. She's got none of the swagger that's going to come to her later. So this is just rote bad guy, good guy action. It's fine. And she crashes into a Blockbuster in Los Angeles, which was a shame because Becca was on the phone to them at the time, seeing if they had a copy of Civil War.
Excuse me.
The line went dead. She had to go to her local video shop, which turned out now to be a hairdresser's. So that was Becca stuffed.
She's been inserted into this film.
Yeah.
J. R. Hartley.
Yeah.
Cheers.
It was quite a good recreation of a Blockbuster, though. All the right sort of period films there as well. Yeah.
Yeah, and some... I mean, I did like the nod to the right stuff as well.
I noticed that, yeah. I've never seen the right stuff, I have to admit.
Is it's good? Very long.
Is it?
Very, very long, yeah. Oh. It's alright, it's worth watching.
How long is it? But...
I can't remember exactly, but
by the
end
of it, are you a trained NASA astronaut?
No.
Chris is going to go and watch a mountain of porn now just to improve his skills, because that's how it works. It's like the bleeding effect in Assassin's Creed.
I'm just going to fill out my application form to become an astronaut. What training have you gone? I've watched the right stuff.
I didn't take a driving test. I just watched a bit of
Days of Thunder.
I just watched that scene from Bullet a couple times. That's it. I drive like a fucking idiot, but I'm safe.
It's a good qualification, isn't it?
Yeah. On the nose as a joke Blockbuster or not? This is the 90s, everyone, or not?
Yeah, it is a bit 90s, isn't it? The hair, the music. The music, oh my god.
The music. I
quite enjoyed it, is what I grew up with.
Though, really?
The thing that got me about the music, and it's very nitpicky, but the thing that sort of how's this work? She later on she goes to Supreme Intelligence, she's got Nirvana, and you know, like Come As You Are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How the fuck would she know what that song about that song?
1991.
Yeah. Well, when she was on Earth,
it's all right. It's music in the world she's doing, but when it's her subconscious, that shouldn't be there.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's a bit odd, isn't it? Yeah. So.
Nirvana were not they were a thing in 1989 because they made Bleach, but they weren't very well known.
Yeah.
Not wide public consciousness. So yeah, that shouldn't be there. It fits nicely. It plays kind of well, but yeah, it's a little bit.
If it's playing in the background, or like on the jukebox or something, then yeah, fine, of course it would be. But
yeah, I've used.
And, and towards the end of the film as well, as like a dinner scene, you can hear in the background R.E.M. song about Put a Man on the Moon. What's his name? He was in Taxi.
Sorry, say it again.
Jim Carrey played in Man on the Moon. What's his name?
Andy Kaufman.
Oh, yeah, I know me.
Andy Kaufman.
Yeah.
Andy Kaufman, yeah, that's it. Yeah, you can hear that song playing in the background as well. So it's all kind of songs that you would expect to be there. Exactly. It's like 90 song kick-ass. Oh, I'm Just a Girl. Blah, 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 blah.
I think I hated that. That was just way too on the nose. I think I used Hole on the trailer. But it was... I think
Horde actually played better in the titles as well, actually, sound tight.
I think the problem with anything period like this is you get music from like the year or two around it and that's it. Well, back in the 90s when I was at university, I was listening to a shitload of Pink Floyd and stuff like that. It's very on the nose to have stuff that was in the fucking chart the week it's set. It's all right. It's nowhere near as intelligently used, nor... as good at creating a vibe as the Guardians films did.
Well, it's
but also in terms of it coming from America as well, like obviously the US and UK charts were quite similar at the time, but you know, we had our very own revolution going on, you know, in the charts in sort of the early to mid 90s too as well. So,
well, 1995 is the year of
you've got Oasis People as well, haven't you? Explosion. Exactly. Yeah. So
But to go back to your point about the type of music you use and how well Guardians did it, Guardians didn't use 80s music. It was basically 70s because obviously that was the stuff that it won.
Better for creating a vibe anyway.
Yeah.
But it just, the whole film sort of surfed that vibe, whereas actually this film has a pretty standard Marvel sounding score that occasionally gets interrupted with these on the nose bits of music. And actually, I'm being too tough on it, because it literally is I'm Just a Girl That Pissed Me Off. That was just like, that is the dumbest choice you could have made.
Was it just a bit too cheesy?
Yes, yeah, cheesy and on the nose. I'm Just a Girl, really? You know, I just didn't like it. I didn't like it as a choice. But then I went through this track today to pick things for the trailer and stuff, and I got to that whole track and thought, oh, that's perfect. You know what I mean? So there's good music in it, but... I don't feel the 90s in it, if you like. It's almost a slight pastiche, a little bit like you get in sort of 70s and 80s films now.
You don't get much chance for the 90s stuff to really take establishment. I mean, you get a couple of gags with, like, you know, CD-ROM and that.
And Radio Shack and, yeah. Radio Shack's
beyond that,
not big in this country.
It's kind of irrelevant.
Yeah, it is. So anyway, the S.H.I.E.L.D. agents come along to find out what's going on. She's used Radio Shack to create some kind of addition to a payphone in order to ring Jude Law.
Yeah.
Don't care how that works, it works fine. She's made some sort of weird
It's alien science.
Yeah.
You know,
she knows from science. Same way she can give a pager that says that'll cross two galaxies.
Yeah.
So that's fine. And there's so Fury and Coulson turn up. Nick Fury, very first shot, I thought, oh, that doesn't look right, but it only lasted a shot. So whether that shot was incomplete or I just got used to it, I don't know. But his hair looks painted on, and Coulson's hair looks fucking weird. And Jude Law is some distance away. I think he contacts Ronin, actually, and says we're on our way. And Ronin doesn't look like Ronin either. I had to check it was still Lee Pace.
He looks like he lost weight.
It looks like he's lost a lot of weight. It looks a bit like someone's younger brother has been cast in the same role. It's a bit like if you bought back the Fast franchise, but it was like Paul Walker's youngest brother playing the same role.
Yeah.
With no digital face replacement or anything. It doesn't look right. I waited for the credits and conspicuously looked to see if it was still Lee Pace, because I heard Ronan was going to be in it, And I think I heard it was going to be Lee Pace, but I thought maybe I misremembered that and I just heard Ronin and filled in the rest, but it is him. And that when he's talking to him, it's very like Darth Vader in, is it Hoth? Where is it?
I got that vibe as well.
Where he's talking to a little hologram of him. That's very
I got that
Darth
vibe
Vader.
Too.
I mean, a little bit of a, you know, well, not say complaint, but what's the point of bringing Ronan back? We know he died in Guardians. I mean, wouldn't sort of introduce like a different like Kree dude?
It's his slavishness to the world building, isn't it? I thought it was pointless. I thought him and G-Mon Hanso coming back was absolutely wasted. There was no point other than to go, it's those same people. And if anything, all you're doing is signposting.
Make it more obvious.
You're signposting because they were bad guys in Guardians.
Yeah.
So I didn't really like that too much. But there you go. It's not, none of that's a deal breaker. What do we go for now? A Skrull attack, isn't it? The Skrulls have landed on Earth. I think there's four of them. I think by the end of the film, we've only accounted for three of them, which is interesting. And they can immediately, you know, they see some surfers and immediately turn into looking like them and things like that. And we just go into an ensuing chase sequence, don't we? Which I think is meant to be a little bit. There's a few films playing in this. The way the car following under the train is very French Connection.
Yeah, I got that vibe.
The fight on a train is a little bit Batman Begins and a little bit Spider-Man 2. And a little bit The Wolverine, actually. There's a bit of all that in it. It's all okay. It's moving along quite nicely. Nick Fury realises Coulson's not actually there, it's a Skrull and that sort of thing. The bit from the trailer where she punches an old woman, the film doesn't have signposts, that's not the old woman. The camera really lingers on the real one as she leaves the train.
Yeah.
It would have been better not to. There's so many bits in this film where I think the directors have actually made a mistake.
I mean, even like the other five people that I saw in the cinema, they'd laughed. So.
Well,
You have the reaction in the film of like the people on the train go, ooh!
Yeah.
Just to say, like, whoa!
Yeah. But again, it's okay. What does she end up? She ends up getting a crystal, doesn't she? I think I think we find out later that's got her memories on it. And then the dead Talos, not the dead Talos, the dead Skrull that was in the car with him is taken to the morgue, and Nick Fury starts talking to his boss, who is being played by Ben Mendelsohn.
Yeah.
So
nobody knows.
Yeah, I just like Ben Mendelsohn here because he's everything we've seen from those other films I've mentioned, because he's playing American accent suited and all the rest of it. But there's something about his movement, and of course he leans in and talks to the corpse and stuff like that. He says, just you working on this, we don't know who to trust. Where does he catch up with her next? Because he catches up with Carol Danvers, doesn't he, Fury, and takes her to the Air Force base.
Yeah, she steals a motorbike, and then she goes into like the travels about, and then Fury's there waiting for her.
Oh yeah, that's it. Oh yeah, because they do a little test, don't they? I think that might be in the trailer. He's saying the Skrulls can take you on, but they only remember recent memories.
Yeah.
So,
so she asks him a bunch of stuff that even like she wouldn't fucking know anyway.
Yeah, I think you're judging how fluent he is. I noticed that. Yeah. I was thinking he could be saying anything. And then I was an ice cream man, and then after that I worked in Blockbusters, and I was on the phone telling some British woman where the Civil War was in.
And then he goes like, "Well, proves to me you're not a Skrull." She like uses a blast. He's like, "Well, that don't fucking prove anything to me."
Yeah, well, whatever. But you know, there's a little bit. Again, Marvel going with a slightly kooky humor. One of the things about him was he won't eat toast that's cut diagonally. Fair enough.
That's a fun fact.
Fun fact.
Cut toast diagonally. He won't eat it.
Everyone knows that, like, you know, that triangle toast tastes better.
Yeah.
Everyone knows that.
I don't like cutting my toast, though. But there you go.
Yeah, I don't do that either.
Well, that's two. That's at least two of the three of us. Chris refusing to comment. So I think that's passed.
Chris, you've got to
well,
cut it
there. Well, oddly, if I'm preparing it for someone else, I will cut it. But yeah, usually I would just like just eat it if it was just me. But thinking about it, if I was making a sandwich, I cut it like straight across, not triangle.
How do you cut your toast?
That's weird.
Write to us at
collectivetalk@gmail.com. Yeah, so if I'm cutting toast, I'll cut it in
triangles. If you've got some weird sandwich habits.
What sort of sandwich do you prefer? Write to us. collectivetalk@gmail.com.
BLT.
Tuna mayo, please.
Two lesbian sisters, I'm just watching. right.
Well, that kind of sandwich.
Yeah. So anyway, she keeps seeing these memories. They think she created some. This Wendy Lawson was an Air Force pilot. Whether we find that out around here, and it's the woman from her nightmares. So she obviously was in the Air Force working for this Wendy Lawson, who was working on some kind of experimental engine. I think that's all we know at the time, but that's what the Kree want. And they're even like rewinding her dreams and stuff like that, so they can actually see what she's looking at and things like that. So that's cool. The SHIELD team come to sort of take them down, but it's actually Talos. And what is it? He feeds Talos some false information, doesn't he, to smoke him out?
Standard
setup payoff. We know that if you say something that was like 2 years ago, he won't know.
Mm.
So he says, I don't know, the wrong name of his dog or something like that. I forget what the actual line is now.
Oh, that meant that time when we were in such, you know.
Oh, it'll be just like wherever it was. That pays off at the end of the film as well. I forget where it was they said now, because Talos says that to reveal it's him at the end of the film. But, and they escape in a jet with Lawson's cat.
Yes.
It may not be a cat. It turns up.
They fly off to see basically the pilot she used to work with, Maria Rambo. So the cat, what do we think of this as a concept, just having this cat in this film like this?
It's great.
Fine, but I'll be honest, I generally don't see why everyone's so in love with it. Maybe because I'm more of a dog person than a cat person, but
it's a very cute cat.
It's a cat, but... it's all right. I love cats. I have a cat.
When the reviews came out and that was like it's the main thing
stealing.
Everyone kept saying.
It's got a funny name.
I thought it was going to be like the dog in The Artist or something. If you go and watch The Artist, the dog steals every fucking scene it's in.
He really does. He really does, bless him.
It's not that. It just isn't. It's just the cat knocking around. In fact, the only bit I really liked was when he was pinned by fucking G-forces, which was
It's a very special cat, isn't it?
That's a very meaningful thing.
Yeah.
To be honest, I think, you know what it is? I think a lot of that, and, you know, it's Samuel Jackson that sells it. It's just his love for the cat. Yeah. It's just like, oh, hey, kitty.
I think you're right there, Chris. I think you're right. So,
we haven't seen this side of him at all, have we? Because the Fury we met was completely untrusting. Well, we're learning why now. It's a retrofit, but that's why. So yeah, they end up.
I'd rather not know, but then
it doesn't matter. You're allowed to have mysterious characters, but there you go. It's fine. And then they head to basically Louisiana, I think it is, to see this person. And all this is fine. The film sort of slows down a bit for a while as we get some sort of backstory. Now, how old is this girl meant to be, Monica the kid? Because Danvers knew her, but she's not that old now. 6 years before, how old was she back then? But anyway, yeah, they work together, so it's just filling in backstory, and I like this, but just because it's another side to Brie Larson. She's now like confused, but we're seeing friendship and stuff like that. We're seeing the young lady that left.
We're seeing like a nice relationship with Carol and the little kid.
Yeah. Lieutenant Trouble, great line, obviously.
Yeah, Lieutenant Trouble.
Yeah. Some of the writing, some of the lines are just a little bit lazy. You can come up with something a bit better than that, but there you go. She learns who she is, obviously. She learns she's Carol Danvers. And not long after, they get a knock at the door and they think it's a Skrull, and it turns out Talos is stood right behind them.
It's behind you.
One's pretending to be
drinking a milkshake.
Maria. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Again, at this point, we think he's a killer, so...
Look, again, it's about identity, isn't it? It's about Brie Larson's identity, well, Carol Danvers slash Captain Marvel's identity, Jude Law's identity, Ben Mendelsohn's identity, the cat's identity, because it's actually not a cat. You know, on Earth we call it a cat, but it's actually an alien, which turns out to be...
Well, it's, Rocket's not a raccoon.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah, he's not a raccoon. He's just
a breed that looks incredibly like a raccoon.
Yeah, and it's all made up of his various metallic body parts, for example. I think that's one of like the easiest main themes, you know, to pick out through here. Yeah. So
it's about finding out who you are.
It's about finding out who you are.
And actually, as cheesy as that sounds, that does work. That does pay off. I mean, the very last sequence as she's unleashing all this power is like, yeah, this was always within me. You know.
Yeah, exactly. It just took for her to go, yes, I can do it.
And actually some of that towards the end is actually really, really well done, but we'll come to it. So we actually find the Skrulls are kind of searching for a home. And Lawson was a Kree. Lawson was a Kree helping them. And they actually recover the black box from... They've actually got the black box, which they were told was destroyed. And it actually unlocks basically her memories. They were trying to destroy this engine before Jude Law got there, and she actually got caught in the... She was killed, and Danvers gets caught in the energy. That's what gave her all her powers and knocked out her memory. And of course, the Talos steals her, knowing she'll be an effective weapon if he can control her. So she's caged, effectively. She just doesn't know she's caged in the 6 years that followed. Which is interesting. They've not tried anything like that before.
What's the thing with the energy thing? So basically just absorbs this energy, and then
she just absorbs all the energy, and it gives her all her powers. That's all, you know. If you think back,
that's like a special event that made her become...
She gets Kree blood as well. She gets like transfused with...
She gets a transfusion from Jude Law, so you know his DNA's within her as well, which is kind of a bit invasive. Obviously, it was to save her life, but. In fact, that's how he finds out when he arrives that there's a Skrull, not her, because the Skrull doesn't know whose blood's within, you know, the version of Danvers he's created.
He's kind of got best of both, really, hasn't he? Human and...
It's like Blade, all of their strengths, none of their weaknesses, or something. Mm. It's very like, if you look back to the 60s comics, so many of these characters were hit by, like, radiation blasts. You know what I mean?
It's a bit like Hulk.
And it's a little bit like that. You're in some accident, hit a blast, and it gives you abilities. But boy, does it give her... So she's absolutely coursing with some sort of energy. And then Talos takes them to a ship, which just has a load of Skrulls there, just without a home. It's a refugee boat, you know what I mean?
Yeah, so it was basically the place that they were going to. It was like where originally Mar-Vell was.
Was
going to sit where, like, and they have the Tesseract.
Yeah, it's the Tesseract, the same one we saw in the Avengers, you know, and so on. Now I'll look it up again when we get to the Avengers, because I've forgotten already. I can't remember what stone that is. It's the one that he takes from Loki at the start of Infinity War. It's not the Power Stone, because he already had that. It's not reality. It's not time. It's not soul. I can't remember what stone it is. What's the other one? Tesseract is the... Hang on a minute. Which stone?
Endstone.
Moonstone, that was it.
It's the Space Stone.
That was it.
Yeah. I made, before I sort of went to see Infinity War, I made a real effort to like remember what they all were, where they were, and all the rest of it. And as we were going, and as we've reviewed some of the films earlier, I've been able to say that's that stone, like the ether is the reality stone and things like that. It doesn't matter, but yeah, this is just that's presumably what the Kree are looking for as well. They want that stone. So yeah, the Kree turn up while they're on this ship, and we're getting towards Act 3 now.
Yeah, because the Kree all turn up. They think they're home and dry.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jude Law shows up and goes, surprise!
And tries to switch off this implant in her. But of course, yeah, she's got her full memory now, and I think realises that actually was holding her back. It was suppressing her powers, though she doesn't know how to use them. But obviously, yeah, she gets full access to her powers now, and that's what Act 3 really is. It's just, it's a mixture of her absolutely unleashing power on everybody, and Fury holding a cat that turns out not to be a cat, that's got tentacles and God knows what else and can kill people. Don't know what I made of that, really. It felt like an overplayed joke.
It scratched his eye.
That's a little later.
Yeah, now we know how that happened.
I just, I feel like it's something we didn't need. I felt like, you know, there are things you don't need to need. I think I'm stealing this from another podcast on another show entirely, but I'm sure there was a similar joke about having a story about how Rocky got his hat. And it's just like, why would you ever need to know that? And I think that's true here. What do you guys think? Is this a nice little wrinkle? And, oh, it's quite funny because it's something a bit inconsequential. I think his reaction to it's quite funny afterwards. But I didn't want to see
this.
It's
one of those things that you don't kind of really need to know. Because, like, you know, we heard, like, snippets of, like, you saying, oh, well, you know, did this happen? Did it happen that way? And he's like, well, I will neither confirm nor deny that.
That's funny, because it adds to his legend that, you know, there was something.
Yeah,
it
adds to his mystique.
And I like the fact that when he says, oh, it's just a scratch, and Talos sort of shakes his head like, no.
You know what? That seemed like such a bum joke. Full discretion, they kind of like, I kind of lead in the ass, and they kind of like, before told me like that. So when it came to that, I was expecting how it would play in my head, and how it actually played, was like way better, because in this film, that it just kind of like, it just, rather than like, I expected it would be some sort of reaction, like someone would like look to Talos in a kind of like, in a kind of reassurance, like, will it get better? And he'll kind of like, just kind of like almost shake his head. But here, it just like cuts flat to his face, full screen. He goes, no. And it's, where the fuck did that come from?
It looks like an insert.
Yeah.
I like the idea, though, that he thinks he's been scratched by a cat, and he's been scratched by something, or an analogue of a cat, and he's been scratched by something a bit more dangerous, if you like. So,
bear in mind, it contains Tesseract as well, so I don't know if that played.
But why are we... Well, we're discussing it because it's in the film, so I mean this rhetorically. Yeah. Why are we even discussing this? There's a stupid little fucking throwaway moment that's just really silly and pointless. And we've seen all that scarring around his eye over the years, you know, coming out from under the patch. So there was clearly some sort of major infection that took hold there. But it does go under the category of don't need to know, don't want to know.
Yeah, yeah.
Unless it was a really cool story, and this isn't it. So.
Yeah, I mean, I said to you before, like, you know, Mick Fury's a guy who, it's all pointy, mysterious, so keep him that way.
Yeah.
Like, maybe add a few little fun things here and there that don't give away too much, but
it's no different to me than giving me like Mike Myers' backstory or something.
Yeah,
don't need it, don't want and it actually detracts from the character.
It would have been better if it, you know, I mean, in this one he's basically still like a suit, so it would have been better if it film left us him as a suit.
I think that's the point. I think it's fun. Some people wouldn't like it because they'd say, well, that's a completely different character. But yeah. I like the idea of dropping back in time and seeing him completely different. And then in the next film, because I will assume, rightly or wrongly, he will turn up in Endgame, even if it's fairly late. Well, in the very next film and the very last, well, two films ago, we saw Nick Fury we know. And I like the idea of, like, I wonder how he went from one thing to the other.
Yeah.
You know, from a middle, not middle ranking, because he's got super high security clearance, but, you know, in the way the character comes a lot, he's like a mid-ranking civil servant or something in the way he's playing it here. maybe a low senior civil servant, something like that. I think this it's film's obsession. It's a very Orson and Kurtzman thing to do, even though they're nothing to do with this film, of having to show us everything, of having to show us how you go from one state of affairs to the other, without trusting an audience to go, well, we didn't see him till like 13 years after this. Of course he changes.
I think it's just that temptation to explain everything. It's like, oh, we're in the past now, so we might as well just...
That's exactly what I'm saying.
Yeah.
His total self-confidence, it will get better, was kind of amusing. But, yeah.
Was it worth it?
No.
No.
No. So what have we got now? Oh, when she defeats Yon-Rogg, she basically puts him in his craft and sort of gives it a kick.
Yeah.
I found that as a battle, you know. I thought it should have... That should have had the emotion of, like, Bruce Wayne taking on Henry Deckard at the end of that film.
I mean, it kind of played a bit more like Indiana Jones with the... kind of just take the gun and shoot him in a weird way.
Yeah.
But I was kind of expecting it because, you know, as she says, why the fuck should she really? Like, who gives a fuck?
Yeah. Yeah, but again, she's now got a skill set where we're all sort of... We're all sort of a bug on a sort of lapel or something. Do you know what I mean? Just, you can just be flicked off, no problem. So we'll see. I don't know. We'll see how this plays. I've got worries coming out of this film, but I have to say, during Act 3, this character and actress really bosses it for me. And because they've built the themes and she's letting loose, and I think a lot of people will find it cheesy, but I even like the flashbacks to... Because we keep getting flashbacks through the film to her at different ages. We get her as a kid, karting, and she crashes, and you've got this guy saying she should have gone slower, and then you've got her as a young trainee in the forces, leaping from one rope to the next and missing, and saying she's too emotional. Which, again, does fit into the slightly feminist themes that there are, like, every time it's a man telling her what she can't do. But the bit where she gets up with... She's with the Supreme Intelligence revealing herself... And she gets up at the same time as, like, her flashbacks get up, and then she bosses the rest of that scene. And I think that's really well done. I do think that's really, really well done. But like I say, that power level is going to be very, very hard to write properly. But then, presumably, they've done it in comics for years, so it must be possible.
Yeah, I kind of get it. It was a bit of, again, I think it's kind of what I feel about the rest of the film. I kind of see potential to feel what you felt, but like, we only had that montage at the beginning of the film, and nothing since then kind of like resonated. It didn't sort of remind
there
us
wasn't
like,
a, there wasn't a constantly repeating theme through the film of she's constantly been held down, held back. You've got the start of the film where she's clearly very subservient. She gives it a bit of mouth, but that's it. And you've got those flashbacks, and then you've also got the reveal when she says to Rambo that women can't fight in combat, they can't fly in combat at this point, or they couldn't in 89. I don't know when that changed, because it has changed now.
Yeah, it changed recently, hasn't it?
I don't know how recently, though. I don't know if it changed in like 2000 or 2015. Do you know what I mean? I don't know. Or whether it even changed in the 90s. I don't know, but it changed. So the film is trying to seed that this woman has found herself, her power, her ability, and like tapped into like a self-belief, and it almost sells it. I like the idea that it's reaching for it. That alone makes it more ambitious than, say, a Thor. Not going to argue it's better than Thor. I think it is, frankly, but I know like probably both of you will disagree, and I don't think you're wrong. I just think it's a different way of looking at it. I think there's quite a lot of ambition in this, but they don't follow through with it in a lot of places. You're absolutely right, Chris. I've never thought about it. They seed all this stuff at the start and then ignore it till the very end of Act 3. Oh, sorry, no, the very start of Act 3.
It's that. I think mostly because you never get grips with her character. There is that theme, but I don't think it's there strong enough to make you feel... I mean, you get it when you see it. You go, oh, okay, I get it, but... It didn't resonate.
Having said that, if you'd stressed it any stronger, it really will have put people off who thought this was just going to be like a feminist diatribe. As it is, it isn't. There's nothing wrong with like a woman finding herself and her powers.
No, I mean, I'm more for trying to like, you know, see beyond those kind of things, because, like, you know, just think, well, it's the same thing as if it's Doom.
But the film has to make it ignorable for you to be able to do that, so it can't stress it too strong. The fact is, if you're in the Air Force and you're a woman and you're not allowed to fly because you're a woman, the people telling you you're not allowed to fly are going to be men. You know what I mean? So that does follow. Racing is still a very male sport. There are women in it. You do get women in, like, IndyCar and stuff like that. There's no women in Formula One and haven't been for years on the grid. It's a very male sport, so they have deliberately picked iconography of very male pursuits. But I think all of that's really well done. But basically, Yon Rogg, I still struggle with that name. Yon Rogg is, like, off planet now. She's she promises to the Skrull she's going to help them find a home, and then she departs, having given Fury the pager we see at the end of Infinity War.
Yeah, so she buggers off for 20, how many years now?
Well, depends if nitpicking whether Infinity War takes place last year or this year, and it's a shifting timeline, 23 or 24 years.
Right, okay.
So they took a long time. It must have been sort of very few properties on the market for her to negotiate for them.
And she hasn't aged a day.
No, she still looks the same.
Yeah, we don't know what her aging thing is, you know.
Although her hair's slightly longer, I noticed.
Yeah, we'll come to that in a minute, because she actually looks a little bit better, but it suits her better. I'm not making a general point about long hair. It just suits her better. The one thing I thought was really, like, clunk was the whole Avengers initiative thing at the end.
Oh, he goes to write Protector, and then...
He's written Protector Initiative, and he's about to outline his treatment. I don't know what you would call it. Proposal, I guess.
Is that maybe like a... I've got it on the brain. Like a Gerry Anderson reference. He's like, Protectors is...
No, I think it's pick any other term but the Avengers, so we can Avengers. Joking.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
And then he sees a picture of her by her plane, and it's Carol Avenger.
It's named after her, Well, that all ties it all in nicely, doesn't it?
And they didn't actually show it on the screen, which I thought would be even more Aussie and Kurtzman, but the inference was clear. I guess it's all tying it in together, but yeah, it's all right.
I mean, at first you would think, well, surely Cap's the first Avenger, surely. But then I suppose thinking about it, you know, they wouldn't necessarily have the idea for the Avengers when Cap.
He wouldn't be called the Avenger. He's marketed as the first Avenger to us.
Yeah.
We're building to the Avengers, and he is the first. Because chronologically, he's the first of them that are going to form part of this team. That's not a retrofit. That's not a problem.
Yeah. So it does make sense, especially seeing as it's Fury's baby, really.
Yeah.
That it would be like the one person he counted.
And you'd give it a code name. I don't really have a problem with it as such, except it's just a little a touch on the nose. But then, this is a mass market film. You're going to get some on the nose stuff, I suppose.
If you didn't have like all the other all-beating stuff like with Fury, like the scratch in the eye or things like that, if you just had the Avenger bit, it probably would have sold a lot better. Would have been, but yeah, I think. Sometimes a little is better, you know.
Mid-credit scene is present day, and it's post the snap. It's Cap, Black Widow, Banner, Rhodey.
Talk about having nightmares aren't as bad as this.
I'm really weird on these things. If I've not seen a film very often, I sometimes have the Wikipedia page up or something like that, but then I almost refuse to look at it because it feels like cheating. So I'm trying to name them, and it's on the screen I'm refusing to look at. But anyway, I think the teaser at the end of Ant-Man for Civil War, I think this is a scene from the film.
Yeah, definitely.
I don't think this has been shot for this. They're trying to get this thing to work, or it's been running for several days and has conked out. They think it's something to do with the battery, which Banner or Rhodey, one of the two, says they bypassed. And then Black Widow, I think, turns around and Danvers stood behind her and says, "Where's Fury?"
And she seems pissed.
She seems pissed off for some reason. But yeah, she looks the same, but with longer, slightly, you know, a couple of inches longer hair, basically. And then the post-credit scene, as is getting common with Marvel now, the mid-credit scene is plot-related, and the last one's like a little joke. Or the mid-credit one is a tease for a future film, and the last one is a joke based on the current film. So with Ant-Man and the Wasp, the mid-credit scene was something related to like the Avengers films, and the last one was like an out playing the drums. The post-credit scene is Goose climbs onto Nick Fury's desk and throws the Tesseract back up.
That's the one massive hairball.
The problem is the second little sting is never as good as the first one or as important, and you have to wait longer for it. Because you always get the end of the film and the title, and then you get some of the headline credits, and then you go mid-title, and then you get everyone in the world who worked on the film before you get to this. It's always shorter in just a little sort of...
I guess the reasoning is it's kind of like, all right, well, if you're going to stay for one, it is this one first.
Yeah, stay for the important one.
Yeah. If you're really hardcore, okay.
Yeah, I think I knew what the last one was. I've been very selective in what I read, and I'm very good at selectively reading, like, synopses and things like that, so I can look at a synopsis and get straight to, like, what the post-stingers are, just so I decide if I want to stick around. And I couldn't bring myself to get up and leave, but I knew it was going to be this so-what thing, but... There you go. Remembered that a bit better than I thought I was going to, actually. I know I had a little bit of help, but it was okay. Just final thoughts from me. It's middling Marvel, but I think middling Marvel now means good. I mean, it doesn't mean... I remember saying somewhere in Phase 2, and I said it to Chris on a summer review show a couple of years ago, that the mediocrity of these films is hiding in plain sight. But I said that after Phase 1, which had... in my view, two really good films out of the six, and we just had Civil War, which I like now more than I did at the time, but I just thought was good. I now think it's very good, in fact. But we'd had that really good year in 2014, but that was it. And aside from that, you'd had Phase One, which was a lot of standard heroes' journeys type films, like Thor being a very obvious example. And they're fine. None of them are really bad. They're fine. Iron Man 2's not very good, neither's the Hulk, to be fair. And then Phase 2 was good in places, but the Avengers film wasn't that good. That finished it off. Well, it technically finished off with Ant-Man. But Ant-Man was alright. Ant-Man was pretty good. But they kept flattering to deceive. They were building this like really cohesive universe that was incredibly impressive, with people on unprecedented length of contract. So getting people like Chris Evans to come back year after year after year, and Robert Downey Jr., even Robert Downey Jr. probably even more so, because his career really took off early in Phase 1, and he was doing things like Sherlock Holmes, and he's done other things as well, if I think about it. It seems odd to be sat here at the end of a series where I've said that, where the films are not as good as the universe it comprises. But actually, this film will go somewhere in the middle, and I did a written review of it where I gave it 4 stars. Now, that's a soft 4 stars, a very soft 4 stars, and arguably I should have given it 3. But I enjoyed this. It had a really good pacing. I think this is a really good lead. I think Chris is right, and I've not really thought about it. We need to learn more about her. About what makes her tick, not just a backstory. You know, a character isn't just a series of events that happen to them.
Like, who they are as a person. I mean, I was thinking about this even today. Like, you know, even like if you think about the first Avengers film, I could probably tell you something about Hawkeye, and he's like brainwashed.
Well, let's pick a more analogous example. I think this might be, and I'll have to think about it. I think it's a more stylish and full of personality film, but I think this is a more consistent film than Captain America: The First Avenger. Captain America: The First Avenger works best when he's little Steve. After he's had the super soldier serum, it's nowhere near as good, but it looks great. It's got a lovely look and feel and score and everything. I've got a lot of affection for that film now, but you knew Steve when the film finished. You knew Steve when Thor finished. You knew Thor when this film finished. You knew about Carol Danvers, and that's not the same thing.
Yeah.
That's not the same thing. We knew about her. We got that backstory. As though that did all the character lifting. But Brie Larson's really good. I think she's managed that tightrope, you know, between having to play lots of different flavours of a character. And when you say all that, you think, well, surely you must know the character after all that. You don't. But the fact is, she plays nervous. She plays green. She plays a bit sassy, or a bit rebellious, if you like. She plays sort of the tender friend. She plays the sort of loving aunt figure. And then, you know, she plays the sort of jokey two-hander, the sort of buddy cop bit, if you like. and then finishing the film, she plays the swaggering superhero. So I think this is a character that can do anything. And when I look forward to the Avengers, yes, I worry about her skill set, but I think she'll be able to interact with everybody. In that, you look at Robert Downey Jr., and he's an alpha in every scene. He dominates every scene he's ever in, or pretty much. Carol Danvers will be able to be in the back of a scene or the front of a scene. She'll be able to like go against the Robert Downey Jr. and then throw a bit of sass around, but she'll be able to have a more heartfelt conversation with one of the other characters, maybe. And I think there's endless possibilities here. The film itself is really well paced. That's its big selling point for me. I wasn't thinking a lot about its flaws as I went through it, because I thought, right, we're about 3/4 of an hour. Oh Christ, we're 1.25 hours in. This is going all right. A few too many like little Easter eggs, you know, Fury's Eye, we've already talked about, you know. So, on balance, really good mid-table Marvel.
I think you just summed it up for all of us, really. I don't know what else to really add to that.
I say my main problem is the character. I mean, I've already established that. We don't find out enough about her. Mostly frustrating for me, because I just saw a lot of potential and a lot of it never really fully achieving. But, you know, cast are great, Ben Mendelsohn's great, Samuel Jackson's fun. Actually quite like Jude Law as well. You know, the time he was on, he played an ample villain.
Jude Law's very underrated on that basis, because he can do most things.
Yeah.
You know, he's pretty good. He's good at light comedy as well. Jude Law can do most things.
Yeah, I mean, the stuff with, like, you know, the training and the fighting, it was with Brie Larson was actually pretty, you know, was pretty decent. So it had all this, like, you know, different ideas. So when I kept hearing stuff about the Xbox and Marvel, it just felt like he's doing a lot of weird new things.
It's structured very Marvel. That's
yeah, it does fly through. I will give it that. It doesn't sort of establish as much as I'd want it to make any of it work, but I never felt bored. So that's something to say. That, you know, I can say it does just, you know, Dave is right, the pacing yeah. is really...
And it's probably more, most like, similar to Thor in sort of structure and hero's journey. Whatever you think of the relative characterizations, there were bits of Thor where I was thinking, get on with it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'll give it that.
Get on with it.
Speaking of getting on with it,
get on with it.
Even though I saw it yesterday, I don't even know anything about it, Dave.
Well, the trouble is, I saw it on Saturday, walked out feeling pretty expert, and then immediately forgot all about it. So I really need to learn. Becca.
Yes.
You don't have any fun facts, do you?
Fun facts. Number one. I have no fun facts.
She quickly looks at IMDb trivia.
I did, unfortunately. Fun fact number two. I have no fun facts.
I have a fun fact. The cat in the comic, in terms of the comics, is originally called Chewie, named after Chewbacca.
Okay.
But here it's named after Goose. And
that must have been a Top Gun reference, I'd have thought.
Yeah.
Because there's a bit of Top Gun. I mean, there were two films. Yeah. The film I was actually quite worried it would evoke was Green Lantern.
It is very green. Captain Marvel is very Green Lantern-y.
You know what I mean? Just the whole, yeah, you know, test pilot thing at the start of the film. It's a significantly better film than that, thankfully. And I was probably a little bit worried it would evoke Top Gun, because I'll watch Top Gun with a fresh mind, a fresh, you know, pair of eyes next year, because there's a sequel coming and I'll probably see it because we'll cover it for a summer review and stuff. So if I'm going to see that, I need to watch Top Gun again. But my memory of it is I never really enjoyed it very much. We'll see when I watch it again. But I was expecting a lot more grandstanding, you know, military bollocks, and there wasn't much of that at all.
Another fun fact, Keanu Reeves was almost cast as John Rog.
Alright, that would have been interesting.
I can't imagine him essaying a character that you could genuinely believe anyone can learn anything from.
He's very zen, isn't he? He's very zen. I think he would have been too zen to be a villainous character.
I must stress about Keanu Reeves. And we're covering John Wick, but we're probably not. We won't cover it in time for its release. We'll cover it like next year or something, or whenever we get to it. But he is an outstanding physical actor. And on balance, when you think the only job you've got as an actor is to convince people of what you're doing, on balance, you have to say that makes him a talented actor. But in scenes where he talks, I'm never that impressed. I don't. In fact, in John Wick 2, it was positively off-putting. It really did feel like the director had said to him, play this as flat as you can. And it doesn't work. But so I think they made the right choice going with Jude Law. I think he's pretty good. There's not a lot of him in it anyway, really, comparatively.
Yeah.
But there you go.
I have a random fun fact, actually. I remember reading an interview with Ben Burns, and he said, oh, it took over 2 hours to apply his makeup. So there we go. He spent, to achieve that look, he spent over 2 hours in makeup.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I did actually see that. But yeah, I'll stop banging on about Ben Mendelsohn now till he next does a Rent-A-Villain fucking film. But, like, thank you for making, for doing something a little bit more layered. And only a little bit. It's a Marvel film, for God's sake. But
he's actually quite funny in it, really.
But yeah,
he is actually, yeah, he's got to do
humour, so. Menace, and, like, evoke empathy. And that's far, far more than he's asked us to do in recent films.
I'd like to see a film where he plays a really nice person. Like, a really nice guy.
Have you seen Place Beyond the Pines?
No, it's in my to-do list.
And also, Stanley, he's on the train sequence. He's actually reading the script for Morass.
Of course he is. Of course he is.
Yeah,
that's true.
We didn't get back to that scene. Basically, the bit where him and Bree look at each other just goes on several beats too long, particularly on Bree's side, which tells me that's an insert. And it was just a, you know, here's looking at you, kid, fucking moment. And it was just like, we'd done the tribute.
I have a question, though. Is this the last one, or is there another one in Endgame?
No, there's two or three to come.
Oh, they've already fucking done them. Jesus Christ.
I think he's done, he's done Endgame. I believe he's done Spider-Man.
You
don't have to do that every time I say Spider-Man.
You know what? I have no idea what the connection between Spider-Man and Russia is. I don't know why.
To be honest, I'm all right with Becca saying that. We can say what he likes. We never criticise each other's like contributions. I'm just aware we're a couple of weeks away from Homecoming, and it will do my fucking head in.
Because he uses the theme music, so every time you hear it.
Yeah.
I just hear spider figures.
And Away From Home as well.
Well, it's because I'm not a big fan of spiders, so obviously I, you know, whenever you hear it written on the internet, it's always like spoofed that it worked with a SP0DR or whatever, or, you know, they mix it up by the way, so it ends up spinning, like, you say spondle instead of spider. So that's basically how I shield, like, the scariness of it. I'm always like, oh, I'll try to infantilise it or make it sound silly or make it sound, you know, ridiculous. Fair enough.
Please don't do that when we do Homecoming. It's going to drive me
no,
nuts.
No, I won't. We're just going to... We'll have, you know...
But, you know, there's a few more in the camp. I think they used to get in for a day here and there and just film several of them. They would just know enough of their script that they say, if we put him in this environment and get him to say this or look like this, it will fit. I'm not even convinced he's on set at the same time as people.
That's probably true.
Certainly when he did the Ant-Man and the Wasp one, I'm pretty sure I've seen a shot of him stood against a green screen. So he's not there in the street. They got him in a studio, stood him next to either a car or part of a car against green screen. But yeah, there's a few still to come. But yeah, it's coming to the end, and then I would imagine, I don't know, maybe just get like a still shot of him somewhere. I think it was it Venom? They didn't shoot one, but they had like him on a mural or something.
Yeah.
You know, just do something like that if you have to. I don't mind either way. I mean, he was never going to live forever, was he? So,
no. I was just wondering when the final one was, because I reckon there must be... I don't know. But this one kind of oddly felt like a final one as well, that's the thing.
Yeah. Well, of course, the Mole Rats thing is he would have been shooting Mole Rats that year.
Yeah. Mm. Which is, of course, my favourite Stanley cameo of all.
Yeah, I'm trying to think what my favourite of his cameos was in. I mean, the Deadpool one was quite good because he played a bit of a perv. I quite like the Ant-Man one just because he's mouthing. That's funny.
Actually, I do kind of like one of the Spider-Man ones. I think it might have been in the second, the Andrew Garfield film. And I think he's listening to records or something.
That's
he's got his giant, giant cans on.
That's the first one. Huge fight.
And they've got all this fight going on in the background, and he's just there. I mean, it's not like one of the best.
No,
but
no,
it makes me smile.
That might be the best one actually. But I was thinking...
Which one's that?
In The Amazing Spider-Man, he's like in a library listening to music with the fight going on behind him. That's pretty cool. But yeah, so not much for that to come. But yeah, it's obviously the first released since he died. So I'm glad we sort of talked about it. And I'm glad the film did something. Social media, folks.
Well, you can find this podcast and all the other shows we did previously on cinematrotsco.uk. You can probably find me on Twitter. You know, I barely tweet because
you retweeted my Ricky Gervais review. I saw that.
Yes. I might retweet Dave occasionally.
He doesn't very often. So I thought, has Chris suddenly watched that then?
No, not yet. I haven't had a chance. But I will.
It's not for everyone. I think it's going to be quite divisive. I think people whose opinion I trust won't like it. But I've watched it through like a couple of times now. It's really, I thought it was great. Ricky Gervais' new sitcom Afterlife, I really loved it. With caveats, if you read my review, I'm quite tough on it, but I end up going, on balance though, it's one of the most moving things he's ever done. So anyway, as for me, you can find me at ThePastyKid1976 on Twitter.
And you can follow us on Twitter at @expectasatalk. You can also find us there on Facebook under the name Do Expect Us to Talk. Likewise, where you can find us on YouTube. Also, we are on Stitcher, on Podbean, also on iTunes. If you type in Do Expect Us to Talk. If you like what you are hearing, please kindly give us a 5-star review, as it can help us to attract more listeners and rank higher in the search. And if you really want to drop us an old-fashioned email, pretending you're again in print, so you have to give us all your money, you can drop us an email at expectusatalk@gmail.com.
Give us your money.
Give us your credit card details.
Just before we announce what's coming next, news is coming in. The UK has voted to join the common market.
Ted Heath says yes. He sends his approval.
A new era in Anglo-European relations.
That'll go well, I'm sure.
Okay, we are there, folks. Ignoring the fact that we've recorded these out of sequence, we are there. There is one more film to go. After that, we will go on to do at least one commentary. We are toying with just making it one now, we'll see. But that will be Chris's choice. Originally, we said two. We may still do two. And we will also try and get Charlie in for a music of the Marvel Cinematic Universe before we rank all 22 films. The 22 films that end with Becca.
We have come to the end, as we return with Avengers Endgame. Dun dun dun.